Welcome to Go Big or Go Broke, where you'll learn the method, madness, and making of impactful millionaires. And now, here's your host with the most, Kathy Karabetsos.
Well, hey there, podcasters. I'm Kathy Karabetsos, your host of Go Big or Go Broke. Today, I have with me a very special guest. She's a chartered psychologist and founder of the PAME Code. Her passion is to help people embrace their true worth so they can live happy and fulfilling lives. Through her academic, coaching, and research career, she's worked closely with individuals and communities to unlock their full potential using simple and easy-to-apply methods for limitless success in life. She is the number one best-selling author of Psychology in Your Life, of book series including titles such as The Imposter Syndrome Remedy, Change Your Life for Good, and Fear Is Not My Enemy. She's also now helping aspiring authors fulfill their lifelong ambition to write and publish their own books with her flagship course, Self-Publishing Made Simple. Please join me in welcoming to the show Dr. Emmy Vida Estacio. Emmy, thank you so much for joining me today. It is such a pleasure to have you on.
Well, thanks for having me, Kathy. Such an honor.
Oh, thank you very much. Well, I'm going to dive right in. We always start out with, tell us a little bit about Emmy, the lady that you are, the girl that you grew up to be, and then how you came to be in the line of business that you're in today.
Well, as you've mentioned, my background is actually in psychology. When I was 15 years old, I went into university. I actually was supposed to go into med school. But my mom told me, oh, look, you're too young to go into med school. You might get traumatized by all the stress and the chaos in hospital. So she suggested for me to take psychology as a pre-med course instead. And she said, you know, after you finish psychology, if you still want to go into med school, then by all means, go to med school. So I followed her advice. And what happened was I enjoyed psychology so much that I've decided to do post-grad in psychology instead of going into med school. So I took a master's. I moved to the UK. I'm originally from the Philippines. I went to London to do my master's, and then I was offered a PhD studentship, and then I was offered a lectureship, became a lecturer for 10 years in psychology. But for some reason, I felt as if it wasn't enough. You know, being in academia, it seemed as if the pond was too small. I was talking to students. I was talking to researchers. It felt as if I could do so much more. I could reach more people if I went out of academia. So what I did with all of my knowledge in psychology, I decided to write books, you know, self-help books that would apply the principles of psychology to help people overcome imposter syndrome, to manage their fears, to change limiting beliefs. And yeah, so that's what I'm doing now, and I absolutely love it. I should have done it sooner, but you know, this is what I'm doing now, and I absolutely love it.
When did you launch? When did you pivot and make the change and decide that you're going to become an author of this major series and some books? Tell us a little bit about when that happened and what was the pivotal moment you said, because it sounds to me like you knew you wanted to go big, which is beautiful for our show. What was that pivotal moment, and when did you actually make the transition?
Well, actually, it's go big or go broke, right? Well, academia has always been my comfort zone, you know, right from the start as a kid. I've always been a nerd. It's just so comfortable. But the pivotal moment was actually when I gave birth to my son. And it made me realize that there's so much more to life than just the four walls of academia. I can reach so many more people if I went out of that comfort zone. It's a little bit scary, but I know that I've got what it takes, and I only have one life. So, you know, I just made a decision. I have to make the most out of this. If I stay within my comfort zone, who knows, maybe 40 or 50 years down the line, I might regret it. So I'd rather take this, make a mistake, maybe fail here or there, but at least I've done it. And I could be proud that when I grow old, I can look back and say, look, I've made these steps. I made the most out of my life. And it's a life that my son could be proud of, you know, that his mother did all these things.
And surely he is, I'm sure. How old is your little guy?
Oh, he's 4 years old now. He's not too little and he's starting school next week.
I'm sure he totally loves mom and he will take your advice just like your mom gave you some great advice many years ago. And you know, woman after my heart, everything that you just mentioned really describes a true entrepreneur wanting to go big, wanting to make a huge impact in the world, giving back to society, making a dent, leaving a legacy for our children. So wow, I'm so glad that you did decide to jump right into it. And you're going to be saving and helping so many people. And this subject that we're going to talk about, imposter syndrome, seems to be all the language right now on the social media, because we have such a, we're living in such a fast-paced digital age. And there is this imposter syndrome, and I want you to describe it and then see how you're noticing it across all of social platforms today. It is kind of a little bit of an epidemic, and I'd love you to tap into that. Tell us a little bit about what it is first.
Absolutely. Well, imposter syndrome is this persistent feeling of self-doubt, inadequacy, and feeling of incompetence that even if you've been doing something for many, many years, even if you have the abilities and the expertise, you still feel as if you're not good enough at what you do. You feel as if you're just winging it. And you have this fear that sooner or later, people are going to find out that you're a fraud. You know, you have this self-doubt that, oh, you know, maybe people are just thinking that you're good. But at the back of your mind, am I really that good? So it's really doubting yourself. And what I can see now in social media, in this fast-paced digital age, there are jobs or there are careers that are relatively new, you know, jobs that never, you know, didn't exist 10 years ago or even 5 years ago. So there are some people who feel as if they are frauds because they are coming into this career that are relatively new and they're not really sure if they are good for that. You know, they don't have like decades of experience to back them up. But what they are forgetting is that they have all sorts of skills, knowledge, and experience that makes them suitable to these types of new careers. Absolutely. So that's why I think it's quite rampant in this day and age, because there are a lot of career paths that are still being invented, you know, that didn't exist years ago. And people are feeling as if, oh, you know, I'm so new, but I'm showing people that I'm good at this. Well, you are good at this, but just because you are new in it doesn't necessarily make you a fraud.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think we all have self-doubt from time to time. So it's really easy to get hooked right into that feeling like I'm not good enough. How am I coming off? Am I being perceived one way when I'm actually another? And you play this mind game. And I think it happens to all of us from time to time. It's when you can own the fact that you are good enough. You are brilliant enough. You are smart enough. You're exceptional enough. You're brilliant and bright and you're individual and unique and just take it to the world in your rare and wonderful form that you were given and you aspire to be. So thank you. This is so important, such a good subject. How does one recognize that they have it? Now, you've touched on some of those characteristics, but how does somebody stop and after they're listening to us today saying, well, Emmy and Kathy talked about this today. I wonder if I have it. How would they recognize that this is something that they're contending with?
Yes, there are several characteristics of imposter syndrome. So one of the common ones is this denial of competence. So you may be doing something good. People are recognizing that you are good at what you do, sure, but you tend to deny it. Yeah. You know, you are thinking as if, you know, it's not that I'm good. It's just that I got lucky. Or, you know, it's not that I'm good. It's just people are being nice and polite. It's almost as if you cannot accept compliments. You cannot accept that you actually own your success. So if you're someone who's been getting praises and, you know, lots of positive feedback and you're still feeling guilty as if, oh, you know, I don't really deserve it. Yeah, that's like red flags everywhere. That's, you know, a clear sign of imposter syndrome because you're doubting your own abilities. Even if everyone is telling you that you're good at what you do, you just can't embrace it. So that's one thing. The other common characteristic of imposter syndrome is maladaptive perfectionism. Now, we have to differentiate between adaptive and maladaptive perfectionism because it's actually quite good to achieve perfection, you know, to aim for perfection. You know, you keep trying, you know, you try and try again until you perfect what you do. That's adaptive perfectionism. That's okay. Maladaptive perfectionism is when you beat yourself up too much when you achieve even the 99% already and you still think, oh,
you
know, I'm such a failure. I'm never going to be good at this. So people who experience imposter syndrome tend to focus on what went wrong rather than acknowledging and celebrating what went right. You know, they can't recognize their strengths. Sure. They only focus on their limitations and they beat themselves up as a result of that. So it can continue in this spiral because, you know, they're doubting themselves. They do something, they achieve amazing things, but because of the maladaptive perfectionist tendencies, they can't see that they're making any progress. And that just perpetuates even more self-doubt. So those are two of the most common characteristics, but there are plenty more when it comes to imposter syndrome. And
this is why I tell my kids it's so important that we stop along the way to celebrate the small moments, the small wins in our lives, in our personal lives, our professional lives. And my children are student athletes, and they're very good, so they tend to be very hard on themselves as well because there's such the stamina of being the best in their field or on the soccer field or whatever. But celebrating those small wins, I think, is imperative. So you tell us, you're the expert. How do we go about starting to tap into remedying this syndrome?
Right. Well, that's actually one of the reasons why I called my book Imposter Syndrome Remedy rather than Imposter Syndrome Cure, because self-doubt will always be there. Every time we have new responsibilities, every time we try something new, you will always have this doubt that, you know, I'm not quite sure if I'm good enough for this. Of course, you'll have that thinking because it's new. Sure. It's totally acceptable. But when we try to remedy imposter syndrome, the first step really is to recognize that it exists. You have to recognize that these thoughts exist, that these feelings exist. So you need to be aware first and foremost, and then you need to manage it effectively. Now, in my book, Imposter Syndrome Remedy, I talk about the TLC technique. And when I talk about TLC, it doesn't really mean tender loving care. You know, you're not giving your limiting beliefs some tender loving care. It's close to that, but not really. But TLC is actually a questioning sequence that you can use to explore the beliefs that you have about yourself or the circumstance. So the sequence goes like this. You ask, is it true? Is it logical? Is it constructive? Because most of the time, the limiting beliefs that we hold about ourselves or about a situation may be untrue, they may be lies, they may be illogical, and they may be destructive. So it's really important for you to first of all be aware, and second, explore it and use the TLC questioning sequence so you can always root yourself in what is real, what is logical, and what is constructive.
Incredible advice. I just read an article this morning about, again, on athletes being mentally tough, but recognizing when you are going into that moment where you're doubting their self-doubt. One thing that they had recommended, and maybe this is part of you, just recognizing it is huge. It's a key to success in everything that you do. So when you're having a negative thought, even saying out loud, stop, I'm recognizing this, stop. It just kind of sets your mind off. How do you feel about that? Like little triggers like that, being aware of it and saying, telling yourself, because I notice in my own life, I happen to be a very positive person for the most part, but I'll have self-doubt. We all do. We'll have a moment where you start thinking in your head, what? And then you catch yourself. And I have, without knowing that this is ever a thing, I've told myself out loud, stop. Like if I'm getting too emotional, or whether that's happy tears or sadness or anger or whatever that is with myself or with others, I'll just tell myself to stop. And it seems to work for me. Is that something that you would suggest that people like pay attention to it, to what they're feeling?
Yes. Well, for most people, that could be a little bit of a struggle because it takes a little bit of self-awareness. You need to be, what do you call this, emotionally intelligent. You know, you need to be aware of your thoughts and your feelings and how to manage it well. But for some people, it might be useful to actually have a coach or a mentor or even just a buddy, you know, to keep you in check, because sometimes these limiting beliefs or these feelings, they are so ingrained in us that we can't even recognize that these are lies. Yeah. Or that these are, you know, we just embrace them as our truth. So I'll give you an example. One of my clients, she's actually a teacher in New York. And she came to me and she was saying, I've been teaching in this school for many, many years, and I feel like I'm a fraud. I feel like, I'm a failure and not doing well in my job. And I would ask her, why do you think this way? Why do you feel this way? And she would say something like, because my colleagues, they are doing innovative things, and it seems like I'm the only one who's not doing great things. Everybody's doing better than me. And we applied the TLC questioning sequence, and I asked her, is it true that your colleagues are doing better than you? And her immediate answer was yes, of course they're doing better than me. However, when you ask that question, is it true, especially when you have an outsider asking you this question, you would ask, well, where are you basing this answer from? Do you have evidence to support this? Because if you're answering just based on your perception, it may be clouded. You don't have data, if you like. With me being a researcher, we always base our answers on evidence. We base our answers on data. And when you ask that question, is it true? She automatically said, yes, it's true, because she embraced that belief as her reality. And for people who have imposter syndrome, if they say things like, I'm a fraud, I'm a failure, you ask them, is it true? Usually their automatic response is yes. But if you ask them, where is the evidence, usually they will draw it back. So with my client, she said, I don't have actually any basis for that. It's just my personal observation. And I would say something like, in terms of your own performance, have you got feedback from students, from parents, from your boss? What kind of feedback are you getting from them? Like the objective feedback. And she said, we have annual reviews, and I actually always get rated excellent in my work. And I said, well, there you go. And her immediate response to that was, well, my supervisor is my mentor. She's a friend, and she's just being nice to me. So, you know what I mean? So, you need to be aware of the characteristics, and having an external person, whether it is a coach or a buddy or a mentor, to point that out and show you that some of these thoughts are untrue, illogical, and destructive, it could be a way to make you become aware of your thoughts and how you can manage it effectively.
I love it. This is so important. It's important for children. It's important for adults. It's important for any walk of life and business and otherwise. So such an important subject today. Would you say there's a blend between imposter syndrome internally versus that external, meaning we're watching our neighbors, our friends, our business peers and colleagues doing something, and we like the way that they feel or they sound or they appear, and we begin to then duplicate, replicate, or in this case, become this imposter of them? Does that make sense? Is there that transition off into trying to be like someone else?
Ooh, that's an interesting question. I'm not entirely sure if people are trying to copy other people, but if there are some success stories that we can learn from, when you pick up evidence of good practice, if I look back, with my client who was comparing herself to her colleagues, and actually this happens a lot, now in this day and age with social media, we compare ourselves to other people and we feel bad about ourselves when someone is actually doing better. In the TLC questioning sequence, the last question is it constructive? Because if you are seeing other people and you think that they are better than you, it doesn't really help you. What you can do if you want to reframe this, if you want to make it constructive, instead of it being about you and what kind of a failure you are, it's actually about them and what you can learn from them so you can better yourself. So it's not it doesn't necessarily have to be a competition. Those people are doing well. It could be a source of inspiration. It could be a source of motivation. They show you what is possible, and you can emulate that. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to be like them, that you're going to be them, but you're picking up certain practice and things that are going well so you can also improve what you're doing. So yes, in the TLC questioning sequence, ask, is it constructive? Because even if other people are doing better than you, maybe it is true that they are doing better than you. The question about logic, you know, is it logical? Just because they're doing well doesn't necessarily mean that you're not. But to make it constructive, you know, you can actually pick up what's going well with them, use it as a source of inspiration and motivation, show you what is possible, and learn from what they are doing. And you could emulate that and learn from them that way.
That is so healthy, and it's such a healthy way to look at it. And we hope that anybody listening today who may be suffering from imposter syndrome could take that and say, now I get it. I understand. I can look at that somebody and celebrate their success and say, what would make me feel happy if I would take a piece and a part of what they're doing away, learn from it, and be able to apply it to something to make it my own? And that's such a healthy way to be, because I think as a business owner, we do look to people that have walked the path before we did. In my case, it might be somebody in my industry. It might be somebody I totally look up to because they have accomplished more or other things that I would like to accomplish, and they've already been there. So I want to watch them. I want to learn from them. I want to be taught by them or mentored by them, but I don't want to be that person. I just want to be able to say, is there a way to, so to say, hack getting to where I would like to go without having to go through all the trials and tribulations that come along with being a business person or anybody in any profession. So that is such great advice. And I love the healthy a way that you can position it. So let's talk about, is it called P-A-M-E or PAM? Pain?
It's actually a Greek word. It's called PAME. It's PAME. Yes, if you go to Greece and you'll hear people say PAME, it means let's go together. Yes. And it basically I adopted this phrase PAME, you know, because in this life we can actually go together. You know, life is more meaningful, it's more beautiful, it's sweeter when we celebrate and go together. We share our struggles, we share our wins, you know, we go together in this life. But I also use the word PAME, I use the letters of PAME to refer to purpose, action, momentum, and energy. And it's just a reminder that, again, in this life, we always have to remember our purpose, you know, anchor ourselves in our purpose. But the purpose is meaningless if you don't couple that with action. So you have to take action. The action needs to be consistent so you keep up the momentum, but also surround yourself with positive energy. You know, surround yourself with good people. Don't burn yourself out. Look after yourself. Look after each other. So essentially, that's what PAME is all about. So we can go together, but always remember your purpose. Take action, maintain the momentum, and keep the positive energy up.
I love it. I should have recognized this. I am not Greek, but my husband is. And we just came back from Greece. So when you said that, as soon as it was coming out of your lips, this makes so much sense now. Of course, everyone says PAME. So this is awesome. I love that you've taken that from the Greeks. And it's wonderful. What a great acronym as well. Tell us today, how, if somebody's listening to this conversation, we always wind up ending the show on this note. They're listening to us today and they're saying, wow, this is a great conversation and it's something that I could take away. But can you give our audience a couple of practical tips or ideas that they can reflect on the conversation today and say, you know, these two ladies are going big in their lives. I know Kathy and now I know Emmy and I'm going to do something different and big in my life. What practical tips can you suggest to our audience today that they say, yeah, I can do this too?
Well, first of all, if you want to go big, certainly the fear will strike you because if it's not scaring you, it's not big enough, right? So when the fear strikes, you just have to be aware of this emotion. And what we are talking about today with self-doubt and imposter syndrome, these feelings exist. Some people, they like to crush it. Some people, they like to banish it and fight with it. What I would say is recognize that it exists, embrace it for what it is, explore where it is coming from, make a conscious decision to do something about it and do the and use the TLC technique. If you want, you know, ask, is it true? Is it logical? Is it constructive? And when you assess it in that way, you can make a more informed decision. You can make a more informed choice on what you need to do next. But in the essence of PAME, make sure that you also go together with other people around you, surround yourself with positive people around you so you don't have to go through it alone.
I love it so much. So tell us the ways that you are working with your clients today, because I know you want to go big and you want to touch the masses. So it's going to be hard to work on one-on-one with you, but how might you serve the audience if they wanted to reach out to you? How might they work with you if they wanted to get in touch with you?
Yes. Well, in terms of going big, I actually do have a book series on Amazon. I published my books in 2017 and my books are still number one on Amazon. So I'm really, really happy about it. So if they just search my name, Emmy Estrada, or type in imposter syndrome remedy, you'll see the second book in there. It's part of it's a three-part series. The first book is called Change Your Life for Good, which looks into how you can apply psychology to change old habits and apply new ones. The second book we talked about today, Imposter Syndrome Remedy, and the third book, Fear is Not My Enemy, and it's all about recognizing your fears and again, you know, making that informed decision on what to do with that fear so you can pursue what you want to pursue in life. So that's how I try to reach to as many people as possible. You know, read those books. They're all available on Amazon on print, Kindle, or audiobook. Yeah, I have audiobooks too. So if you're not offended by this voice, yeah, I narrated my own books.
Magnificent voice.
As well. But I also work one-to-one with some clients if they want to work with me one-to-one. And I also have an online course for those entrepreneurs who want to write and self-publish their own books. I've been through that journey myself. And, you know, if you have an inspiring story, if you want to reach so many people with your expertise, you know, go ahead, write a book. You know, there are 30 million readers on Amazon. You know, just go for it and reach as many people as you can with your books. And I can teach you how to do that with my online course, Self-Publishing Made Simple.
I love it. Self-publishing made simple. And we'll put that in the notes. Is there any way online in terms of social media that our guests can find you?
Yes, I'm on Facebook. I do have a Facebook group, the PAMICODE Facebook group. And also for the successful entrepreneurs, coaches, and visionaries, we have an online community on Facebook called Self-Publishing Made Simple. And it's a community of, yeah, aspiring authors and entrepreneurs who are writing nonfiction books and aiming to go big and go number one on Amazon when they launch their books.
Oh, I love
and
it.
I'm there live every Tuesday. I'm live doing my live Q&A. So if anyone wants to ask anything about writing and self-publishing on Amazon, I'm there live.
I love it. We'll have to stay in touch with each other to see how we go big together, right? I'm so excited. Thank you so much for joining and sharing with us today. It's an absolute pleasure to have you on the show. It's an incredible topic. I'm completely intrigued with it. I think anybody in business, in any profession, is intrigued with the syndrome. We have to do better. We have to do more, and we have to recognize it. Thank you so much for sharing with us today.
Thanks for having me, Kathy. I hope that was valuable.
It was wonderful. Podcasters, thank you so much for joining us today. Please subscribe to the show using that big red button and rate the show if you would. Share it out to all your friends so they too can go big. I am Kathy Karabetsos. You can find me at kathykarabetsos.com. I'm on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. Have a grateful day and do not forget to go big.
You've been listening to Go Big or Go Broke with Kathy Karabetsos. If you enjoyed this episode, then you better play big and hit that subscribe button.